Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to another edition of Real Talks. I'm your host, David Steele. I want to apologize for the little late start there. I was finishing some stuff up for you guys, so make it easier on me. So, as I said, welcome, and welcome to the weekly roundup. So, this was a big week, as usual, bigger than most for a couple reasons, and we're going to get to those in a couple minutes. So, Kyle's not with us today, and he'll be back for the show on Monday, so not to worry about that. I think, as a matter of fact, I think he's going to see Avatar for the fifth time. So that's why he's probably breaking records. And we'll get to that story in a couple of minutes, like I said. So, as I said, it was a pretty big week for entertainment. We had a lot of stories really hit the wire and really make its presence felt. So, So let's go through a couple of these. Right off the top. So, Tomb Raider. So, this is going to be our first story. So Tomb Raider is one of those stories or one of those franchises that can never really seem to get going. It's had a couple of iterations. You know, it's with Alicia Vikander, who Academy Award winner. She actually did it a couple of years ago. And then you had Angelina Jolie before that. And, you know, I mean, once again, video game adaptations that really don't hit home at all. So this is really something that, I mean, we've talked about it all the time. And this may be part of the Last of Us type of thing, and they're trying to readapt this and everything else. We, you know, that's to be said. Anyways, so as it stands, Amazon, who, of course, you know, they've got money coming out of the kazoo, is now ordered the Tomb Raider, the franchise. So we are going to get a new and improved, if you will, Lara Croft. And it's one of those things where Lara Croft is one of those characters that's very interesting because, you know, it's an adventure game, okay? And, you know, I hate to say it, but it's a female Indiana Jones type of thing. And so you can see right there on the left, the former iterations, that was the PS2, I think, the PlayStation 2 game. That was one of their exclusive games that was on their system only. And so it was a huge hit. You know, you went through and you solved puzzles and, you know, it was an action adventure type of thing. And it was really good. Then they brought Angelina Jolie in and they thought, okay, we're really going to step it up now and do really well with this. And so it was okay. The first one was okay. I had no problem with the first one. They decided to make a sequel that really wasn't the best. The Cradle Life, I believe it was called. And so they just said, okay, we need to go away from this. And finally, you know, only, I think it was 2018, they rebooted it again, this time with Alicia Vikander. And now, okay, that once again, that didn't do too hot. Now, today, we have Phoebe Waller-Bridge's. She is going to be the new Lara Croft. And I'm really, really interested to see where the story goes, how the story goes, what puzzles and everything else. How are they going to do this? And mind you, there's something else to be said here. This is going to be a series. It's not going to be a movie. And I think that that's going to give them a little more leeway and a little more character development and everything else. Because when you put everything into a two-hour film, it's really difficult to have a condensed version of whatever that character is in 2 hours. And so it's one of those things where, I mean, we don't know how many episodes it's going to be and everything else. So that will be interesting to find out too. I don't know. I'm interested. I'm intrigued. I got to be honest. I'm intrigued. I think that this is going to be an interesting series. I think if they develop the character a little bit more. It's going to be fascinating to see where they take this and who the villain's going to be. Because, and once again, this is all going to, they have their Laura Croft. That's fantastic. Let's see who they get for a antagonist. Let's see what kind of story they put together. Let's see how long the seasons are going to be, or the season is going to be. I don't know. I'm fascinated. I mean, I played the game back in the day, as millions of others did, and loved it. So translating it to the small screen, the big screen, or in this case, the small screen, it's one of those very, very difficult things. And as I said, I think this is impartial to The Last of Us and its success and how it's doing. So I think it's going to be more of a grounded series. That's what I think. I think it's going to be more of a mature, grounded series, and, you know, it will be fascinating to see. So I'm curious, what do you guys think? Do you think that this is going to work for Amazon? Do you think that this is going to be another bust? Do you think they should just try it with another movie? Leave us your thoughts down in the comments, because I'm really curious to hear what you guys are going to say about that. So let's move on. And so we're going to move on to this movie just keeps traction unbelievably. So we've been talking, and I say we, Kyle and I have been talking about this for ever since its debut. And just today, okay, yesterday it broke into the top five. Today it has broken into the top four of all-time grossing films. Think about that. That's an amazing, amazing achievement. So what you have is you have three of the top four films of all time directed by James Cameron. And I know, guys, we keep harping on this, but this is something, there's something to be said about the success of this film. And I really believe this is one of the most underrated achievements of not only the year, but of all time. And I think that this really goes to show you what kind of staying power this has had. So this has, as it says, it's the fourth highest film of all time, just crossing one of the other ones. Okay, and so the only films in its way right now. This is an amazing achievement. So the only films in its way right now are Titanic, which, by the way, he directed. You have Endgame and Avatar. I don't think it'll hit. Endgame. I just don't. But I do think it will hit. I do think it'll hit Titanic, and so that's a huge achievement. As it stands today, this movie has made a little over $2 billion at the box office. It's grossed $1.466 overseas, and it's $608 million here domestic. Think about this. One of the greatest MCU films of all time was Black Panther. That grossed $700 million, and it was only one. Well, now there's two films, but that first one was. So that just shows you. And this has only been out for 6 weeks. Now you say, well, most of it's overseas, international. Doesn't matter. The fact that it's overseas is even more of an achievement. And I think that you've got to take your hat off to James Cameron. And, you know, as many of the people out there have said, never doubt the man. Because this guy is just, he's a juggernaut. He's an absolute juggernaut when it comes to making films and characters and everything else. And there is not enough superlatives out there to say what that man has done. And not only this film, but other films in itself. So, I mean, I think Kyle is actually going to see it for the fifth time today and can tell us on Monday. Unbelievable. Unbelievable, unbelievable film. He now has three of the top four not only highest grossing films, but directed films. What do you guys think about this? So what I want you to tell me how many times you've seen Avatar. Tell me why you've gone back to see it. Tell me, have you brought any new people to see it? And tell me if you think it's actually going to be able to hit Endgame, because it's going to pass Titanic probably by the end of tomorrow. So I'm dying to know your thoughts about it. And tell me, guys, in the comments, are you excited for Avatar 3? Because that comes out in 2024. And that's, you know, so that's going to be fascinating to see. And tell me, do you think it's going to carry over? The success is going to carry over into the next film. I'd love to know all your thoughts about it. So leave me your thoughts down in the comments about that. So let's move on to another big story that happened this week, and that's Oscar nominations. So the Oscar nominations came out this week, and we're not going to go through all of them. So we actually did two streams. Okay, Kyle and I did one stream, and then I had Matthew Anderson, who's a fantastic Oscar predictor. He got 16 of the 18 categories right last year. So we had him on for a second stream later on the day. So nonetheless, we're just going to go through a couple of these real quick, the top five. So Everything Everywhere All at Once led with 11. And then you had two films that tied with 9. And that was All Quiet on the Western Front and Banshees. So there were a lot of films that, you know, I mean, I think everybody was, there was no surprises. There were a couple of surprises, though. So we had, you know, in the Best Actress category, and this is the talk of the town right now, is Andrea Riseborough getting in for Two Leslie. And the marketing and how it was done, and everything that was done about it, really was interesting in how it was done. And, you know, the thing on Twitter is, you know, there needs to be an investigation of how they're going to do that. I don't know if they're actually going to do this or if this is going to be a, you know, just a thing about it. I mean, she came out and she said she was ecstatic. So essentially, a little bit of backstory about this. She had Kate Winslet come out and basically say this was one of the best performances she'd ever seen. And I mean, I'm not quoting her verbatim, but she said it was one of the best performances she'd ever seen, and she deserves an Oscar nomination. And that just carries, I mean, when you're hearing it from an Academy Award winning actress, it carries some weight. Subsequently, the Academy obliged, and they gave her the nomination. And the thing is, this film only made, and this is true, about $20,000. So how does, you know, how does somebody like that get an Oscar nomination when you have somebody over there like Viola Davis, who poured her heart and her soul into the Woman King and is left out? It's just one of those things I'll never understand, and really speaks volumes to not only the Academy, but everybody voting in there. Anyways, this, and the other interesting tidbit about this is Ana de Armas. I mean, she's probably number three on everybody's list. This is a two-woman race, and Cate Blanchett and Michelle Yeoh. Depending on what happens at BAFTAs, depending on what happens at SAGs. So Ana de Armas, so why this is significant is because this is the first time an actress actually got nominated for an NC-17 film. So that's one of those things where it's fascinating to see how they're going to do it. And if other actresses decide to take the risk later on and say, well, she did it, because Blonde was not received well at all. So it's one of those things. And so Michelle Williams, okay, she got in for The Fabelmans, and there was a big to-do about whether, was she going to go into Best Supporting Actress? Was she going to go into Best Support or Best Actress? And that kind of threw everything up in the fold. So, which is interesting because now when you look at the best supporting actress category, we have Angela Bassett, who's a favorite. Okay. And then you have a couple of others. Okay. Stephanie Hsu I was very happy to see her get in, as well as Hong Chu for the menu, or for, she was in the menu. it was The Whale though. But yeah, I was really happy to see that. I think Bassett, once again, depending on what happens at BAFTA, depending on what happens at SAG, this is Angela Bassett's to win. But yeah, it's going to be fascinating to see how that whole thing plays out. But yeah, so the Oscars came out, and as I said, there were a couple of surprises. I mean, the Viola Davis snub was clearly a snub. You know, the slide here moving over there was Best Director. I mean, the director didn't even get in. I mean, The Woman King got absolutely no love this award season. And it's a shame because it is a phenomenal film. And when you see what she's done, it's almost, you know. And by the way, Viola Davis is an Academy Award winner. So it's not like she's, you know, 25, 26, just starting out. No, she's won before. And so, yeah, so it's one of those things where I don't know. We'll see what happens. I'm really curious. I mean, look, the last two awards are going to shake up everything. So, I mean, if you have a split between Michelle Yeoh and Cate Blanchett, who's going to win, you know? Or, you know, right now it's between Austin Butler and, you know, Brendan Fraser. Well, if they split, you know, does Colin Farrell sneak in? So there's a lot of different things. So we have a whole month to talk about that. And prior to that, and I'll put the link down in the description, we're going to get Matthew back on here. And he is just a phenomenal, phenomenal predictor. He, as I said, he only missed two. And as a matter of fact, you can go on his Twitter page and see his reaction of getting the Andrea Riseborough nomination right. Nobody predicted her. It was like a shot in the dark. So I can't wait to get him back on, and I can't wait to talk about this. But we have some other bigger and better things coming to us. So, The Last of Us. So The Last of Us is now a show that it's in the culture. Okay, it's in the culture, and this is a show that anybody who's a gamer, like myself, is really, really wanting to see part two. I love, and by the way, guys, don't forget on Tuesday, you can follow me on Twitter, handle's down there. Don't forget, we are going to be having the editor on Tuesday afternoon. So if you want a question, if you're interested in asking a question, please shoot Kyle or I a tweet, give us your name, your state, where you're from, and ask your question, and we will make sure to get that to Timothy. So, anyways, the fact is, this has now blown up so much. So, as the graphic says, the premiere episode, and it's, you know, it's the second highest, and it climbed to 22 million viewers across all the platforms. I believe, and I could be wrong about this, I believe that the first episode is now free on YouTube, so you can go check that out if you want to get into this. Last Sunday's episode jumped 22% in the overnight ratings. That's incredible. And this, so we're, Billstown's going to be tomorrow. You know, we're going to have episode 3 of this 9-episode series tomorrow. But the big news that Neil Druckmann dropped yesterday was they are going to be making The Last of Us Part 2. Anybody who's a gamer, anybody who liked this show, I am so excited, like fanboy excited about this, because I'm really curious to see how this is going to play out and who are they going to, who are they going to get to play Abby? Who are they going to get to play Jesse? So, as you can see, this had over 200, this game is one of the most decorated games ever. It had over 200 awards given to it. It won Game of the Year. I mean, IGN, GameVid, everybody loved it. We did, you can go back on the, you can go back on the page, and I'll put that link down in the description. So there's a four-part series about that Benjamin and myself did about why The Last of Us 2 is arguably the greatest game of all time. Easily, hands down. The writing, the storytelling, the journey, everything. If they adapt this the small screen, I can't wait. I can't wait. I'm not going to, anybody who hasn't played the game, I'm not going to give away the spoilers, but it's one of those things where, boy, does it rip your heart out. So the next question after Neil Druckmann actually greenlit the second season, a lot of, including myself, I'm guilty of this. I don't usually like to do X actor or Y actor to X part or Y part, but in this case, I'm going to. The fact is, so who are we going to get? So the biggest thing that, the biggest thing that from the first part to the second part is there is a time jump. And that time jump is, so she is placed 14, and then when we meet her in part two, she's 19. So, that being said, who are they going to get? Are they going to keep Bella Ramsey? Okay? Because I think she's great right now as Ellie, but I don't know if she could be as good for Ellie in part two. So, the one person I would say, and mind you, so she is part of the HBO family, and she was in The House of the Dragon. And so this photograph's from her IMDb, and she looks young. And so, mind you, this one wouldn't start filming for at least 2 to 3 years, is Millie Alcock. I think she would be perfect, a perfect Ellie for this. Now, once again, you need somebody to actually be able to go head-to-head with Abby. So I don't know. I mean, this would be a fascinating thing. I'm sure that they're talking about this right now, and who they'd get. So yeah, guys, definitely leave your thoughts down in the comments. Who would you get to play all of these characters? So that is a thought for Elliot 19. Another one. So Abby, so here are the, here, this actor, this name is not correct. I saw that and that's not right. It is not Shannon Woodward actually. But here are the face models. The face models and the actresses for the parts in part two. So she actually played Dina, okay? And she actually, so she was just a, Jocelyn was just the face model. They actually used somebody else's body and did the part. So I'd be curious to see if they actually wanted to go out. I don't know if Jocelyn is a, an actress, but I think she'd be spot on for Abby. So that's something to be said. And so it's one of those things where I think that, you know, you could very easily do that and very easily have that done. I can't wait for the show. I can't wait for this. I can't wait to see how this is going to translate. So it's just one of those things where this is, as I said before, it's one of the best games of all time. I mean, you know, you can think of Elden Ring and you can think of, you know, all these other games out there, these RPGs. Nothing compares to this game. Nothing. And if you haven't played it, it's, you know, so, I mean, they just, Naughty Dog and PlayStation, everybody else just did a story that, the sales just skyrocketed, like 1,000. I mean, it was maybe not 1,000, but it was like 200 or 300%. This game, I know they're coming out with a remastered version of part two. They just came out. They're coming out with factions, the multiplayer version. I know they're coming out with a PC version, I think in March. An amazing, amazing game. I think that this game just, Wow. So it's one of those things where I think that it's if they translate, look, I'll say this much. If they translate this to TV as well as these first two episodes have been done, this is going to clean up the Emmys. Clean up. And I can't wait. I can't wait. Because it's something that, once again, everybody's talked about this. Good video game adaptations are so rare. And when you finally have one, to finally break the mold, you go, it's like getting a monkey off your back, right? So, guys, do me a favor. Give me your thoughts down in the comments about who you want to see play Abby. And do you think they should bring back the actress that played Dina? Do you think they should get Emilia Alcock to play Elliot 19? Who do you think they should get? I want you to do a little fan casting. Tell me who you would get to play all of these roles. Yeah, definitely leave your thoughts down in the comments. I'm dying to figure out and find out who you guys want. But as I said, that's basically it for this roundup. Like I said, it was really, really short. You know, we had a couple stories. Kyle wasn't here, so, it's a little shorter. Couple of things, though. As I said, Tuesday, we have a huge interview coming up. I mean, he is the editor of the number one show, streaming show on television today. And that is Timothy Good. If you want to see this interview, I'm gonna get the studio ready, on Tuesday morning. Guys, stop by. This is gonna be huge. We're gonna pick his brain about not only The Last of Us, but his career. Would he go work on has Neil talked to him about working on The Last of Us Part 2? You know, so many other questions. And we've got a ton of stuff coming up for you on the channel. And if guys like that ticker says, hit that like and subscribe button, because we have a ton of stuff coming up on the channel. That's the only way that I know. That's the only way Kyle knows that you like the content. Leave comments down in the comment section, because we'll get back to you. Every single one of you, we're just starting to grow and we want a lot of eyes on this. So, but I want to show you guys what we have, and I know I do it every time, but this is what is coming up for 2023. We have a huge 2023 plan for you. So after every single episode, including the Super Bowl, okay, including the Oscars, okay, I know that, and it's interesting, it's fascinating, this is going to be done for another time, but episode 6 is going to be during the Super Bowl in 3 weeks. And then the last episode, the season finale, is going to be on Oscar night. So that will be interesting to see. Every single Sunday, we are going to be doing streams for you guys. It's going to be Kyle. It's going to be Destiny Jackson from Deadline. It's going to be Tyler. And it's going to be myself. And we're going to be talking about everything about it. What we liked, what we didn't like, what we thought they could have improved on, what we really enjoyed. Anyways, guys, come to those streams. Say hi. Leave your comments. We'd love to hear from you. If you have any questions, we'll answer those at the end of the streams. So this is going to be going on. We're going to be doing this since, when it premieres all these years later, we're definitely going to be doing The Last of Us 2. So, most definitely. Starting only in a few weeks, we have Ant-Man Quantumania coming out. So we're going to be doing spoiler. For these, we're going to be doing spoiler cast, Kyle and I, are for every single one of these. So you're not going to be getting the weekly roundup, but you definitely will be getting spoiler casts in lieu of that. So as I said, Ant-Man is going to be the first one we're doing a spoiler cast for. So, That premieres in a couple weeks. That looks amazing. Jonathan Majors is going to have a huge year. I can't wait to see how he plays Kang. Yeah, that's going to be a blast. Speaking of Jonathan Majors, he's going to be in another film. A little film next month with Michael B. Jordan. And that is Creed 3. Okay? He looks, and Tyler actually worked on the reshoots of this. He actually met Jonathan Majors. We can get his comments, you know, later on. We'll even maybe have him on for the that spoiler cast. But he said he was jacked. He was absolutely jacked. So, and I can't wait to, you know, see this. And I own Creed 2. I have yet to see Creed 2. So that will be, I mean, I know the plot of it. I still want to see it, though. But this is Michael B. Jordan's directorial debut. So this is going to be interesting to see. And this is a huge, huge film out of the gate for him. I mean, anybody directing for the first time, it's going to be a lot of work because you're starring and directing like Bradley Cooper for A Star is Born and everything else. But this is huge. So I'm really curious to see where they're going to take this. Then we have Guardians. So we're going to skip into there are other movies. I should say this. There are other movies coming out the rest of March and all of April. Okay. We just need to take some time and breathe a little bit and everything else. So it's not that they're not important. It's just, you know, we also want to bring you the very best content we can. So March 5th is when the summer really kicks off. And that is Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3. Dave Bautista is not coming back. We know that. As a matter of fact, Knock at the Door will premiere next week. M. Night Shyamalan is making the rounds at premieres around the world right now. So that's fascinating. But this looks amazing. This is James Gunn's last iteration of Guardians of the Galaxy and his last go around at Marvel. So I'm, you know, he wrote and directed this. I'm sure this is going to be an amazing film. I can't wait as millions of other people to see what happens, and see how that whole thing plays out. The next week, we have Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse, the sequel to the arguably one of the not only the best Spider-Man movies, but animated movies of all time. So that's going to be interesting to see. That being said, I have yet to see the first one. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to wait until May, and then I'm going to go see that, and then I'm going to go see the second one, and then that way I can see it back to back. We have Transformers. I know Kyle's really, really looking forward to seeing Transformers. We're going to cover it. I'm done with Transformers. I mean, I think I've been done for years with Transformers. There's nothing else it can give me that I haven't already seen or done. So that will be, it will be a fascinating watch, though, for sure. So The Flash, arguably, probably, no, not probably, without a doubt, the number one most anticipated movie of the summer. Because this has been a saga and a soap opera for probably the better part of 2 years. Ever since Ezra Miller had all those legal problems and how it's going on and what it's doing. And, you know, so we'll see how this performs. I don't know how good it's going to be. A lot of people said it's tested well. It's tested better than The Dark Knight. But once again, it's a test. You know, once you get it out there, and what are they going to do for promotion? We're only 3 or 4 months away from this movie, guys. Are they going to put a Super Bowl trailer out there? Who are they going to get to do the junkets? There's a variety of different questions to be asked about this. And as we get closer to June, we'll talk more about that. So Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny. And I want to apologize for the graphics, guys. Got a little funky there. But the fifth and final Indiana Jones. Harrison Ford said he's done after this. You know, we had a John Williams score. You know, this is going to be I'm really, you know, we've had one trailer. Are we going to get another one for the Super Bowl? I suspect we are. This is going to be interesting. I didn't see King. I don't even acknowledge. It's like Ghostbusters 2. I don't even acknowledge Ghostbusters 2. I don't even acknowledge Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. So, you know, that being said, so we're going to have Indiana Jones. And that will be a fascinating. So that is actually, it's interesting because that is at the end of June. And so leading into July, okay, we have Mission Impossible. Mission Impossible, and I was thinking about, I was listening to the actual podcast of Mission Impossible. It's called Light the Fuse. And I was listening to this, the 200th episode, which was done August of last year. And they had Tom Cruise on and everything else. And I've always publicly come out and said, I thought this would make $200 million opening weekend. And now I'm starting to backtrack from that because there's going to be so much good content and good movies out there for everybody. I mean, all those movies I just made mention of in June, I don't know if it's going to make $200 million. What I do know, opening weekend, what I do know, it's going to make a lot of money. It's going to make a lot of money. This is going to be the highest grossing Mission Impossible of all time. Not only because of the success of Top Gun, not only because of the, because it is the last Mission Impossible, but because I think that they're really, you know, if you go back and listen to that podcast, they've really put everything into it. And it's got a huge, not saying that this is anything, but that budget is $290 million. Now, to compare that to anything, Infinity War and Endgame cost $250 million, $250 million, $250 million. So this is topping that. And it is part one of the finale. It's going to be fascinating to see where this ends. Because if they do it right, and I've always said this, if they do it right, it's the second one's just going to blow up. Totally blow up. If not, and it's like the Hunger Games. I don't see. It's going to do well. It's going to make its money, but it's not going to do as well as they hoped. Some films that have done it right are Infinity War and Harry Potter. So, like I said, but the stunts and everything else, it's just an amazing, amazing. I can't wait. I can't wait for that movie. And then finally, we have Oppenheimer the very next week. So, you know, Christopher Nolan's back and he's doing his thing. And so there's actually one other film that I didn't make mention of, and that is the Barbie film. Greta Gerwig directed film about Barbie. And that's starring Margot Robbie and Ryan Gosling. I'm really curious to see how that does. Just because, not only because it's about the doll in itself, but because it's going up against a lot of other competition. So as we grow closer and closer to release date, I'll be curious to see how much this is projecting at. Because I think that, and this is just me personally, and this may sound snobbish, I think this is going to do better overseas than it's going to do here in the States. It's just a fact. Because we're more hypercritical. Okay? We, as a culture and everything else, are more hypercritical. So, but regardless. So that's coming out too. In August, I know Kyle's very much looking forward to the new Teenage Ninja Turtle movie. So that's coming out August 8th, I believe. So there's a lot of stuff on the channel that's going to be coming to you guys. Not to mention, I just went through all of that. Not to mention, we have our Perfect Movie series, okay? Which, next week, within 3 days, you guys are going to be getting your second Perfect Movie. And that is Captain America Winter Soldier. So that's going to be fantastic for you guys. That's already ready to rock and roll. That's great. You're going to be getting the first reactions the second week of February. I'm going to be sitting down and watching Fargo. So that's going to be all brand new content. Not to mention, you're going to be getting the roundup up until May. And you're going to be getting a video here and there during the week. Sometimes I'll do a show. Sometimes it'll be pre-recorded. So depends on the schedule. So all of that being said, there's a lot of content on there. Hit the like, hit the subscribe button. I know I keep saying it, but guys, this is what's going to drive this channel out to everybody. And I want this out to as many people as possible. We want this out to as many people as possible. And guys, tune in on Tuesday. That's all I got to say. Because the thing is, this is the number one show on streaming right now. And Timothy worked on 7 episodes. And I can't wait. I'm so eager to pick his brain, not only about what he does and how he does it, but about the industry and talk about that. And, you know, we'll ask him, how do you get into being an editor? You know, what do you have to do and everything else? And, you know, it's going to be a fun time. So, and we're always looking out for interviews. So, you know, stay tuned for that. If we get any more, we'll put them out there to you. Okay, guys. I think that's about it. Thank you very much for tuning in. And let's do the 3 things we need to do. Be safe, be careful, and have a great day. Have a great weekend. All right. I'm David Steele, and you have been watching Real Talks. Bye-bye, guys.